Well, it is good to be back this week. Last week was truly remarkable. I'm going to be teaching tonight the second part of The Five Laws of Liberty, which is a book that I've just recently had published. This is the second part of a two-part series. I want to tell you a little bit more about myself. I told you last week a little bit about myself. I am the Bible department head here at Liberty Christian Academy, and I thoroughly enjoy teaching here at the Academy. I want to tell you a little bit about my family. I have three children, my wife and I, my beautiful wife Jennifer, and I have three children. And we describe Scott as our eater. He is currently playing football at Liberty University. We describe Matthew as our feeder. He is nurturing, and he actually does like to cook. And we describe Abigail as our cheerleader. It's interesting, when we think of Scott, recently my wife had made some tortilla soup, and we usually get about a dinner and then maybe a lunch out of the tortilla soup, and we really enjoy this tortilla soup, and we were eating it the third night, and I said, "What is this called?" And she looked at me and she said, "I don't know. I think people call it leftovers." We're not used to having so much food, obviously, because Scott was normally in the house, and thank God Liberty has to feed him now. We're talking about freedom, which is a serious topic, and last week we asked the question, what is freedom? And we started answering the question by saying, freedom is the responsible pursuit and preservation of life, and no other system of belief accomplishes this better than Christianity. I do believe in the supremacy of Christianity. I believe in the supremacy of Christ. I do believe that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I do believe in Galatians 5:1, where it says it was for freedom that Christ set us free. So keep standing firm and do not be subject again to a yoke of slavery. I want to briefly review the first two laws that we talked about last week. And I'm quite embarrassed because I've completely forgotten what the first law is. Can anybody help me? Remember the past. There you go. I was testing you, okay? Remember the past. And we talked about Hebrews 13:7, and we mentioned Dr. Falwell and just how he was grounded and recalling how this church was started. Hebrews 13:7 says, "Remember those who taught God's message to you, reflect upon the outcome of their lives, and imitate their faith." We also talked about the second law of liberty. Does anyone remember what the second law of liberty was? Wow, I did a great job last week. The second law is embrace the truth. And we mentioned how in our founding documents, you can look at the Virginia Declaration of Rights, which influenced the Declaration of Independence. These famous documents consistently call us back to a creator. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created. So our foundational documents have a presupposition that we're designed by a creator. We cannot forget that. I apologize ahead of time. Last time I used the example of a shark, and I said that we have to retain our freedom, and we defined retain as to keep in possession or use. Sharks, they're scary, but normally we're looking at them from a distance on the TV screen. I want to use another illustration today, spiders. Now, nothing will make my wife scream like spiders. In fact, I cannot distinguish between her scream for serial killers or for spiders. How many of you ladies are like that? I can remember whenever we first got married, my wife would scream, and I would have a coronary, and I'd be locked and loaded running up the stairs thinking, I'm going to have to confront someone, and it was just a spider. Interesting thing about spiders. I was sitting on my deck recently, and I watched this spider who had set an anchor with his web. And I knew that because he looked like he was parasailing through the air. And I saw this web that was trailing behind him. How many of you have ever seen that? They catch a breeze. They're riding the current. I thought, that is fascinating. To me, I look at this spider and I think a creator had to design that. You have this little creature that has the ability to produce this silk. And he had anchored on one side of my deck. And he had ridden this current like he was parasailing all the way to the other side of the deck. So it was about a 10-foot line that he had streamed. I've done some study, and I've talked to some of our teachers at school, and I'm told that a web has the strength per mass, a stronger strength per mass than metal wiring. The spider anchored on one side, and he was making progress forward. And that's what we need to do today. We're going to anchor with the first two laws, remember the past and embrace the truth. Those are our anchors, and they're going to drive the next three laws. And I really would like you to pay attention today, because tonight, as we look at three of the last five laws of liberty, I want to do something a little bit different, and I want to use three different people that, quite frankly, aren't so different in order to illustrate each of these three points. I'd like to use a Samaritan, I would like to use a slave, and I'd like to use a soldier. So I want to go to a passage, if you would turn to a passage in your Bible. And we're going to look at the first law of liberty. I'm sorry, the first law of liberty, which is remember the past. The second law of liberty was embrace the truth. And the third law of liberty, which we're going to examine now, is respect humanity. And as we look at this law, I want to turn to a passage in Luke. Pastor Jonathan has been looking at this passage, the Good Samaritan. I'd like to read this to you. We're going to learn about respecting humanity from a Samaritan. Now, an expert in religious law stood up to test Jesus. Could you imagine testing Jesus? I mean, you talk about students that you have in the classroom, a student that could actually know more than what you do. To test Jesus, saying, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? How do you understand it?" The expert answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." Jesus said to him, "You have answered correctly. Do this and you will live." Now this is very interesting, because Jesus is asking the question, the expert in Jewish law is answering the question, and the expert in Jewish law, willing to justify himself, says, "Who is my neighbor?" He wants a qualification on who is my neighbor. Jesus tells the parable of the Good Samaritan. As you know, a priest walks by the victim in the story, a Levite walks by the victim in the story, and the Samaritan ends up being the hero of the story. Now, something you may know, but I'm going to explain to you briefly. Samaritans were a group of people that were the result of the Assyrian Empire, which took place about 700 years before Christ was born of a virgin. And what the Assyrians did, they had a foreign policy that whenever they took over a land, they would deport the best of the people from that land. So the indigenous people, the Jewish people, many of them were deported. There were many that were left. And then the Assyrians would bring in people from foreign lands. These people would intermarry, and so you end up having Samaritans. Samaritans have a parent that's a Jew and a parent that's from another country. They were looked down upon by, quite frankly, the priests and the Levites. Now, something that I find interesting as I look at this passage when we talk about respect humanity, the establishment, the religious establishment, had a total disregard for human life. How do you walk by someone who is bleeding, who has been victimized by robbers, stripped of his clothing? They walk right by. So the established church, the established religion, had a total disregard for human life. The Samaritan could truly empathize with the victim. The victim had no control over his circumstances, just like the Samaritan had no control over his heritage. And I believe that may be one of the reasons why the Samaritan actually stopped. And Jesus uses the Samaritan as an example of someone who had his heart in the right place. I believe that the priest and the Levite were more concerned about their status than they were human life. I believe for us, as we draw applications, we need to keep this in mind. We will never love a person more than the greatest object of our affection will allow. So if the greatest object of your affection is your career or your status or your finances or chemical dependency, you'll never be able to love a person more than you love that, whatever that is, the greatest object of your affection. I think it's interesting, as you look at this passage and you think of the value of human life, again, getting at the heart of the matter, and we've spoken recently here in the church for the last 2 weeks. Pastor Jonathan has had the model of a human heart getting at this passage. It's interesting when you go back into history and you start to study some of the theologians. One passage that I came across One individual, I possibly could call him a theologian, said that the precepts of philosophy and of the Hebrew code laid hold of actions only. Speaking of Jesus, he said, he pressed his scrutinies into the heart of man, erected his tribunal in the region of his thoughts, and purified the waters at the fountainhead. Now, I said a theologian said that. It was actually a politician. More correctly, a president. Do you think it was, and I want to test you for a moment, do you think it was Thomas Jefferson, John Adams, or George Washington? If you think it was Thomas Jefferson, raise your hand. Few people. If you think it was John Adams, raise your hand. If you think it was George Washington, raise your hand. It was actually Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson, who's supposed to be a deist or an atheist, who also, by the way, set up a chapel on the campus that he established at the University of Virginia. He understood that Jesus was about the heart of man. I think of a Samaritan, just making some practical applications. A Samaritan is someone who acts to overcome or speaks out against an abuse of power. He does not allow his position to cloud his judgment. And I think of another contemporary of Thomas Jefferson, a contemporary that was in Great Britain, in fact, one of the greatest statesmen in Britain at the time of the American Revolution, someone who was also concerned about an abuse of power, Edmund Burke. I'd like to read this quote to you. And this is from Paul Johnson's book, A History of the American People. In 1776, he told Parliament that the crown was abusing its power in America by a succession of acts of tyranny. It was governing by an army, shutting the ports, ending the fisheries, abolishing the charters, burning the towns. So you drove them into the Declaration of Independence because the abuse of power was more than what ought to be endured. Now he scoffed. The king had ordered church services and a public fast in support of the war. In a sentence which stunned the commons, Burke concluded, "Till our churches are purified from this abominable service, I shall consider them not as the temples of the Almighty, but the synagogues of Satan." When you look at that passage, this is from a famous British statesman. He was less concerned about his status, more concerned about the truth, and he was concerned about the abuse that was taking place within the colonies. It's too bad we could not have gotten him together with Thomas Jefferson. We have the third law of liberty, which was respect humanity. The fourth law of liberty that I'd like to look at briefly here is the fourth law of liberty that we must observe is we must control ourselves. Self-control. And for this, I'd like to use Genesis 39, chapter 6 through 10, chapter 39, verse 6 through 10, to illustrate this point. So if you would turn with me to that passage very quickly. Now Joseph was well built and good looking. Soon after these things, his master's wife took notice of Joseph and said, "Lie with me." But he refused, saying to his master's wife, "Look, my master does not give any thought to his household with me here, and everything that he owns he has put into my care. There is no one greater in this household than I. He has withheld nothing from me except you because you are his wife. So how could I do such a great evil and sin against God?" Let me ask you this. Do you think Joseph's heart was in the right place? Okay, and he could be trusted. Even though she continued to speak to Joseph day after day, he did not respond to her invitation to lie with her. He is a slave at this point. His greatest object of affection is Almighty God, and he could be trusted. Joseph could be trusted over larger tasks because he could be trusted over smaller tasks. Joseph could be trusted ruling over large groups of men because he could be trusted ruling over one man himself. When I look at this passage, I think of some issues that we face today. When you think of respecting humanity or a total disregard for human life, I think when you look at this passage, you have emphasized a total disregard for the family, at least from this wife's perspective, Potiphar's wife. She was going to be disloyal to her husband. And I think in our culture today, we have some major issues, not just in our society, but also within the church. And see, I think what's interesting about this passage is there used to be a stigma in our culture about men that would